Now I'm going to go through this process one more time just so I can get it nailed down correctly. You saw things were going awry and it was saving files while I was trying to have a look at the segmented memory. And if you don't do things in the right workflow in terms of pushing the right buttons in the right order, so this is where things go awry. So I'm resetting. If I activate things again, there's our signal. I've changed the time base, so of course things are awry. So I tell you what we're going to do. I'm going to set up for a new mask. There's a new mask. Make it smidgen bigger. Reset everything. We've got it to set up to capture the fails. I'm going to reduce the screen size down, and then I'm going to hit the run. Now you can see with things set up like this, you can't actually see the data. So I'm going to pull this up, but bear in mind as I do this, this is a screen which will be saved. And like for instance, if this information was important to you in terms of the stats, in terms of what's passed and what's failed, the number of waveforms it's looked at, the elapsed time, then you'd want to push this up so that's captured in your screenshot as well. Right, so now that we've got 10 captured events, what I'm going to do is hit the run stop first. I'm then going to stop the mask so that we don't have these images being saved while we're trying to have a look at the history. We'll come up, switch on history, show the table, and pull this back out the way. And now you can go and step through and see all the fails and what was happening. And you can literally set up for thousands of segments if you want. So you can go and step through all of these and you can like see where the glitches are, where your mask was. And from this, this would at least tell you if you're trying to troubleshoot that microprocessor and you're wondering whether it was a microprocessor or your time base feeding a clock signal into the microprocessor, you could go, yeah, there's something wrong with the time base and that's messing up the running and the processing of the microprocessor. So the amount of memory you've got to play with here and the configuration of that memory, I think is brilliant. So if we go here and have a look, I mean, if we stepped up, if I click on that, I could say I want 1,000 segments. I enter that. What it is going to change is obviously your record length, because it's going to have to reduce the record length so that it's got enough overall memory. But you can play with that obviously to balance the number of segments versus the record length. Next, let's have a look at the cursors, because there's a few handy features there. If I just bring up a set of basic cursors, you can see them appear in the screen over here, and then we've got some measurements in terms of the time or period. I should say where the location of the cursors are, then we get a delta T, which is the period between them, and then the inverse of that, which is the frequency. So I can use my fingers to go and move these cursors. Let's say I want to work out the frequency of this wave. I tell you what, we'll go and do it where it cuts zero. And we'll go and move this one. And I know this happens to be a 12 megahertz signal. And we're just about spot on for the time base that we've got. But as you can see, if I just gently roll my finger, it's surprising how much adjustment capability you've actually got on the screen. You can, of course, revert to the knob on the side. So if I pull it out, you've got your knob over here, which you can adjust and make the adjustments like that. So if you don't want to use a touch screen. Then if we go to the cursor menu, there are some other handy features. For one, you can say set to trace. So if I come back here and just move these to random places. Now, obviously, I've only got the vertical. I could have the horizontal as well. But if I go set to trace, the most logical measurement to lock to is frequency. So if I go like that, it'll then go and set to the waveform at the most logical measurement. If I just go set to screen, what it'll do, it'll just reset them. So let's say you've got a cursor which has gone off screen. And I tell you what, let me just take cursor 2. Right out of bounds, so you can see it's not in the display at all. So as I'm adjusting it, you can see the time where we're sitting time wise. then all you'd need to do is if you say set to screen, that brings it back into the screen. And the other handy feature you've got, if I go correct, these are going to make sure set to trace, I could say to couple them. And then when I go move, you can see they are locked together so that I can go and measure other periods, let's say, and do comparisons so that they are locked. And I'll just leave them there at the top of the waveform. And if the other feature you've got is track scaling. And if I do that, if I change the time base, it'll maintain the cursor positions, which is really nice. I can't recall whether the Tektronix and the Keysight did this. But it's a really nice feature because I've been caught, in fact, when I was working on the scope and didn't realize this feature is here. I've been using the cursors and then you go and adjust the time base and realize your settings out. So that's another really handy one. Next, we'll take a look at the FFT function. Now, this is quite interesting. The handy thing is you get the two windows. So you've got your frequency domain and then you've got your time-based domain. You can see over here we've got a lobe, which is showing you perhaps our frequency of interest, and then we've got our time up here. So you tap between the screens. Now, if I change the scaling here, that is going to change our time base. If I tap down to the bottom screen, you get various adjustments. So at the moment, you can see I'm changing the span. I can also change the center frequency. Now, the frequency at the moment, I know it's at 12 megahertz. But if I go and adjust that, you'll see I'm actually unable to get down to that 12 megahertz. So I need to make adjustments to the time base to be able to get there. Right, so once I've got the time base adjusted, I can then go and select my center frequency. So in this case, I'm going to go to 12 megahertz. And that's my frequency of interest. You also have another feature up here where you can adjust the amount of the signal that the FFT is processing. Now, if you're processing more signal that you're capturing, then obviously the FFT has to work a bit harder. Now, what I'm going to do to make that adjustment, if you tap up on your where your signal is, and at this point in time, I'm making adjustments on the time base. You'll also see I've got these white lines defining the window of time which is being used for the FFT. So as I bring those in, you can actually tap on that and you'll see it highlights here W, that's the width of the window and the position. So to center that, I can set it there and then I can adjust the scale. I use the time-based scale button and you can see that window is narrowing. And if you look very carefully, you'll notice that the FFT function will change. What also changes automatically, you can see the resolution bandwidth is changing. That you can set to automatic or manual. I have noted though, it doesn't allow you to go to a really narrow resolution bandwidth, and I'm guessing that's to prevent the scope really bogging down, because once you start getting down to really narrow resolution bandwidth, it's got a lot more work to do. But you do have this capability, as I say, of adjusting this window. You do it with your fingers as well. So if I go and hold on there, you can see I'm adjusting the width, the position at the same time. But you can always center that if you like. Then you also have your normal amplitude adjustments. So if I go down here and on the side, I'm going to use the scale adjustments. I can adjust the vertical scale and the position. I'll just adjust that back up again. So now down on the menu system here, so down on the bottom line of the screen, you've got this menu system where you can make adjustments to the FFT, just like you can do the individual analog channels. If I touch the FFT, you've got a tick or highlighted that you're looking at the spectrum. I could say, show me the minimum hold. So it'll hold, it'll change that. That's the minimum hold. That's the maximum hold is being shown there. I could switch the spectrum off. So you're only seeing the minimum and the maximum. I'll take those off. You can see there's no spectrum at the moment. I'll put the spectrum back on. And then you've got average as well, which is really handy. So then you get that kind of mauve or pink line. If I go and switch off the spectrum and take away the menu, now the averaging, you can get a nice cleaner spectrum line. And you can average out the noise, and it's probably, and it'll be easier to take measurements that way. You've also got this to set to this full span. I think it goes up to 1.1 gigahertz is the full span. On the FFT menu on the side here, you can also change up before you actually do that change. Let's bring back, take away the average and bring back the spectrum. I can just hit menu there. It brings up the menu. On your vertical scale, you've got dBm, dBv, and vertical voltage level. So here you're not going to have a logarithmic scale, but sometimes using a voltage scale can be very handy. But of course, then if you've got power levels which are very dissimilar to each other, a very high level power level next to a low level power level, you're not going to see it on this scale. That's why the logarithmic scale is far more handy for that. It should also be noted that even through every single function, you've still got your memory and your history that's still running in the background. So if I happen to push the run stop here, so remember, if you want to collect that data, you want to go run stop. And if I come up here and I push history and I say show history, I've got all the screens over here. I can scroll through these. I'm using the adjustment button on the side. You can hit the play button and change the speed and what have you if you don't do this manually. But you can go and look at all your waveforms and the corresponding time-based signal as well. So a really nice handy feature that is always being recorded in the background. And again, you can go and set the number of segments that you want to be captured. The other thing to always remember is that you always have the option of when you have split screens like this, you've obviously got a smaller display for each of these. You can go and scale those. So I can take that right up, so I'm not even seeing the time-based scale. I'm just looking at the frequency domain. Or I can pull that down and change the balance, so I'm looking at the time-based scale. Now next, I'd just like to show you what I really like about this kind of high resolution big screen is the ability to have a lot of information displayed at one time. So what I'm going to show you, I've got two signals coming in. They're both around 10 megahertz. And let's say we want to do a comparison. And I did this in the video when I was looking at the GPS disciplined oscillators, was comparing two frequencies to see any phase shift or how well locked they were. So if I bring up channel 2, I've got the other one, and you can see there's obviously a slight frequency difference and it's shifting. I could then, let's say, bring up some measurements if I wanted to have a look at the period. I can switch on that measurement. You can obviously go and select period or peak or whatever measurements you want. So I've got those measurements down here. The statistics is already switched on, so you've got the switch over here. So we went over here, you can then kind of see your minimums, your maximums, and the mean and the standard deviation. And then what you can do is bring up the application screen and go and select your XY plot. So if you want to, let's say, have a polar plot where you can see get a real understanding in the change of the phase between them, so you've got that over there. You've got two individual channels. I like the fact that they go and split it up and it's not on one screen. And then you've got your measurements and statistics over here. Really, really nice. And again, because of the really high resolution, all these numbers, even though they're small, are really sharp and crisp and easy to see. To get out of this, and again, this is where it takes getting used to driving this, to switch this off, you need to go back into the application screen. And you just go back to scope, and then that brings you back to your standard scope. And then, of course, you go and switch off, not cursors. If I go into measurements, you can then go and switch off your individual measurements. Right, so next I'm going to demonstrate a few things. For one, the built-in pattern generator, which is really handy because if you're trying to set up and look at a digital signal or a protocol on a board, you may be having problems, and it's nice to have the reassurance of being able to generate your own pattern, set it up on your scope to ensure that everything's working, and then you can go down to your device under test. So what I've got plugged in, I've got the digital channel or the Logic Pro plugged in. It plugs into the side. Remember, you can have two of these. You can have up to 16 channels. In this case, I'm literally only going to be using two because I'm going to be looking at I squared C with an earth. So I've got that plugged into the pattern generator. On the Logic Probe itself, you have two lights which will indicate which set of channels you've got this plugged into. So when I switch this on, what we should see is light come on which says D0 to D7. So there we go. I've just gone and switched on the Logic light, and you can see the green light has come on, and that is indicating that we've got these set of channels operational. Right, so now we come back and we can open up the Logic menu. Now you can do that either from the side here, or you've got a Logic menu right on the front of the oscilloscope. So we can go and switch that on. Whoops. That comes on. You'll see we've got the little menu down at the bottom of the screen near our analog signals as well. And if you look very carefully, you can actually see two arrows which are up, and that shows that there's a signal on those two data lines. You can see we've got all the channels switched on. Now, as I'm only using D0 and D1, I can go and switch off the others. So this would then allow you to see the signal. And although it's not triggering, if you look in the background, the digital signal is actually on the screen. You can also size them. You can make them reduce the size and position them on the screen. So at this point, I'm not even going to try and trigger on those, because ultimately what we want to do is decode those. But that's how you bring up your Logic signal on the display if you wanted to. The next step is to go into the protocol decoder. So you've got that on the side menu, and you do have a hard button on the front of the oscilloscope. So we push that. We're going to select, we want I squared C. We want to decode on the trigger. You can see here we've got the clock set for D0 and the data set for D1. Go back. There we go. So we've got the signal coming up, and it is decoding it. It's decoding it to hex. So you can see the hex data there. And if I just simply go into display and change that to ASCII, let's see if you can make out what it says. Let's just clear the screen. And if we can read that clearly, it says Rodin-Schwarz RTM3004. So there we go. There's three helpful functions. You've got the pattern generator, where you can send various protocols out of that to test them with your Logic Probe, and then you can go and decode them as well and do troubleshooting that way. Right, so next we're going to play around with some of the power applications. So the first thing I'm going to do, I'm going to plug in this high voltage differential probe. This is going to be just a bit of an introduction. I'm going to demonstrate how these work and a few basic functions. In some future videos, I'm going to go more in depth with these devices, because these are right up my alley in terms of, let's say, measuring harmonics and power on inverters, solar power. Having a differential probe, even if it's not used for high voltage, can be very useful for other measurements. As I've discovered, and if you look at various tutorials online, having something like an oscilloscope and probing circuits for one, particularly if you want to do high power, can be dangerous. So you need the right tools and probes to do that. But when you're probing circuits, even if they low power circuits, your oscilloscope can often mess up their operation in terms of the capacitive loading and the impedance. So we're going to do some videos with those and demonstrating how useful these tools can be for both lower power applications and higher power applications. Anyway, let's jump to it. I'll just plug it in. And what I wanted to demonstrate is when you plug them in, the new firmware automatically brings up this menu. This menu will allow you to set any offsets or do any calibration and setups to make sure that the probe is operating correctly. And likewise with the current probe, which we're also going to connect in a moment, when you connect the current probe, it'll then set up to allow you to degauss it and also zero to make sure you've got no issues when you actually place conductor inside the probe itself. Right, so the first thing I'm going to demonstrate, we're just going to quickly do a voltage measurement of the mains voltage I've got coming off from my inverter. Now, please just be warned, This isn't something you do unless you know what you're doing and you've got the right probes, tools and equipment, because it can be dangerous. Now, I have these leads set up for another multimeter that I use to do power measurements. So I don't need any of the extra probes and leads that actually came with this. So all I'm going to do is plug this in. You'll see on the device itself, it comes up and it'll light up. It'll show you the range, which is set to auto. You can bandwidth limit if you want. So that all is displayed. And the micro button, as I recall, that does the run stop. We'll check that right now. Okay, so with that in, I'm going to just snap that away, scale it so we've got the signal. There we go. So that is our current, or that's the voltage coming in off the mains from my inverter. And as you can see, it actually doesn't look 100% clean. Now, this certainly is a pure sine wave inverter. And if I stuck a few other inverters that I've got on with modified sine waves, you'd see how horrible those signals are. This one has a few kinks in it, so it looks like there might be some harmonics, and we can go and look at the tool to show harmonics. And that might be because I've got a motor which brings fresh air, I should say a fan, which is running a motor running a fan, which brings fresh air into my cabin and my studio. And that may be causing some harmonics on the mains, or it just may be coming from the inverter itself. There could be any number of things. It could be the lighting around here. But anyway, so that's that. If we just flick on the quick measurement, I say I always like just one button and pulling up a quick measurement, and we can see the RMS cycle, and there's our 117, 118 volts, so a 120 volt system. We get our period, the frequency you can just see is bobbling just above 60 hertz, and then the voltage peak to peak, which is around 345 volts. So that's a fairly straightforward thing, but then it's nice having this capability to be able to do this with a set of differential probes, because although you could get a fancy clamp meter to do this kind of thing, when you've got the speed that this can do measurements at, so let's say you've got an issue with transients on your main system or what have you, you've got a really nice capable system of capturing those transients and doing measurements over time with that deep memory that you've got and segmented memory. You can capture things over time. If you're switching things on and off and wants to see what's happening on your main system, you could do that with this. But anyway, the next thing, let's go and do a power measurement. Right, so now I've gone and connected the current probe. Let me just show you what I've got on the bench. On the side here, I've got a rigid fan. This is what I use to keep cool when it gets really, really hot. It's got an adjustable rheostat for the speed of the fan. Now that is connected up through this plug system. So it's getting its power from here, and then I can clamp onto one of these because I've got the live coming through here and I can measure the current. So that's what I'm going to be doing for the next few tests once we start having a closer look at the applications. Now it came up with the menu, you can degauss it. I've already gone and done a zero adjust, so we'll take it from there. Right, so now I've got the clamp actually attached to the wire. We can see the voltage that is being measured. And if I switch this fan on, there we go, that is the current. Now, if you look at this carefully, you might notice something, and this is something I brought up when I was talking about my well pump. And in fact, you really do need to take care of power factor and apparent power. And if you look very carefully, you can see the current waveform is not in line with the voltage. So therefore, there is a power factor issue because we've got a motor running. In fact, it looks like it's lagging. So I'm saying it looks like, and I'm guessing, but of course, the beauty about the scope is if I open up the applications, we can now go to power analysis. And let's just go, you can see, I'm going to start with power quality. So it gives you a setup on how to connect things. You can see the probes, I've got that set up, the current probe. And if we activate that, and I pull up all the data, what it does, it shows you all the information from your channels, and then it automatically brings up a math calculation to do the other stuff. So when I say the other stuff, we'll just go through it. You've got all your different columns for the actual current real-time reading, the min, the maximum, the mean, the standard deviation, and then the number of waves that it's counted while it's doing this calculation. So up here you've got the RMS value, you've got your frequency, crest factor, RMS for your current, the frequency of the current, crest, and then we get down into our math. So we've got the apparent, so volt amps. So here you can see the actual real power, which is your active power, is only sitting at about 13 watts. But your apparent power is sitting at about 25 VA or volt amps. You've got then your reactive power, your power factor. You can see, so this gives it away. You can see your phase angle, and we can see we've got a power factor of only 0.5. So that kind of explains why things are looking so bad. But straight away, you've got all these things brought up. You can make adjustments. So your math channel, like for instance, if I wanted to scale these things, I could click on channel one. I'll just pull you off to the side to show you that I can go and select channel one. I can change the scale, that's of the voltage. I can go channel two, I can change the scale. I've got that set to fine. There we go, out of screen. I can change the scale of that. And you can see the math is highlighted, and that becomes a virtual channel if you like. And if I go and select that, I can go and make changes to that as well. I'll just set it to fine. So I can go and scale it so it fits in the display nicely. But then I've got all this power analysis right here. Right, so next we'll go and do power consumption. As we bring that up again, you get the very helpful diagram to show you how to connect your probes and then an explanation. And if we push that, we've got the waveforms going. And at the bottom here, you've got your power analysis. So you've got the time, the energy, and the active power. So at the moment I've got the motor off or the fan off, as I switch it on, you can see your current scale adjust. So I'll just select that just to bring it down. So there are the waveforms. You can see your active or real power, and then you can see your energy actually building. So this is really, really handy to have this kind of functionality on the scope. And over time, you'll gradually see there's another line across here, an energy line, which will start sweeping up. Now, the one thing you'll note on the time base, you can see it's almost in a roll mode in terms of the time base scale. There, I've slowed it down so you can see over longer duration, the tightest time period or time base you can go to is 200 milliseconds per division. And that is something they'll perhaps change in the future. But ultimately what you're interested in here is seeing the figures and the calculation by the math function to actually give you your active power and your energy over time. Now what I'm going to do quickly, I'm going to connect an infrared lamp which uses a lot more power, just so that we can see the energy curve going up. Right, so next to the demonstration, I've got a heat lamp or an infrared lamp connected, which will pull many more watts than the fan did. On the screen at the moment, you can see the current, there's nothing measured there, and you've got that very fine line. And that fine line, that is a math function which actually shows energy. Now you can have energy in joules, or in this, the one energy measurement is in watt hour. So as I switch this on, you're actually going to see that climb. Now you can of course scale all of these or move them around out the way. I'll just switch on the heat lamp. Bang. So what I'm going to do is just scale things down. There we go. And there is that energy line slowly climbing. And you can scale things so that you can see that climb more progressively depending on the amount of power that you're using. So you can see at the moment, this is a 120 watt lamp. You can see it's pulling 122 according to the measurements. You can see the energy climbing, and there you can see that line climbing. So another really handy tool or application that works really well once you have the right probes to actually exploit the measurements you can take with this. Now, lastly, I'll demonstrate inrush current, and for that we only need the current probe. Now, before I demonstrate that, these power analysis tools aren't the only ones. You've got these tabs here where you've got things like ripple spectrum, switching options. You got power path where you can measure efficiency. So this would be great for inverters. So There are a whole host of tools which we will play with in future videos. But for the meantime, we'll concentrate on the input and we'll look at inrush current. So we'll go there. And it provides you with cursors where it does the measurement, and the measurements are noted on the bottom of the screen here. That is our current line. I'm going to switch the fan on, and as I switch it on, you can actually see our inrush current in that area over there. Now, because we're continuing to run, obviously that disappears. So what you can go and do, I can go and set my trigger level at a point where I know it's going to be triggered. And then I can set up for a single. I'm doing this on the side at the moment. So there we go. I just switched on the fan. I can switch back off now because we've just done a single. And we've gone and captured that inrush current. And then I can go and place the cursors. It just happened to obviously capture in the right place. And if we go and have a look, there we go. Our peak was at just over 2 amp. You can see it says negative 2, and I've probably got the current probe round the wrong way. But if I go and change the cursors, let's say I could go and have, let's say, a look at the running current, which would be around this area over here, and we can go and see that is around 858 milliamp. But taking into account that peak, I can see it was at 2 amp. Right then, so that wraps up the review of the Rohde & Schwarz RTM 3000 series oscilloscope. And I'll just give you a few of my thoughts in kind of ending off where I think the strong points are and where there might be some improvements. Now, in particular in regard to, let's say, the Keysight and the Tektronix scope. Now, the Tektronix scope, as I said before, it's got a lot of functionality with what they've added onto it. But even though the performance figures state that, let's say, the waveform updates per second are higher than the R&S, I certainly found it to be sluggish in certain applications. Then the Keysight, in terms of performance, is the all-out winner. With those ASICs that it's got great hardware which gives it really good performance. But what I really like about the R&S, for one, is that screen size. Now, I know the compromise is the vertical adjustment per channel. You have to select the channel before you can make that adjustment because you've only got one knob as opposed to four knobs if you've got the four channels. But I would rather have that compromise and the bigger, more high-definition display that it's got than, let's say, that of what's being done on the Keysight. And in terms of the performance, as I said, I've been really surprised because that quoted waveform update per second is certainly lower than, obviously, the Keysight and the Tektronix. I've not found it to be sluggish. It seems to manage the memory depth with your time base well to give you good performance just about all of the time. The big strong point for me, which I really enjoy, is for one, the applications. Particularly, I enjoy those power applications, and I'm going to be doing a lot more playing around with the probes that I've got. And then that memory depth. Having that amount of memory that you can sit there and capture things over time and have that configuration with the number of segments you want to do, for me, is a great selling point. So all in all, a big thanks to R&S for putting this into my hands. Again, a nice one which throws it into the competition of both Tektronix and Keysight. It means the more they compete with each other, the better it is for us, the consumer. But anyway, thanks very much. I hope you enjoyed that review, and I'll catch you in the near future for another video.